Savana. Now we move on to the last talk of the session, that is dyspareunia affecting female sexuality. And to talk on this, we have Dr. Archana Shah from Ahmedabad. She is MD Obstetrics and Gynae, Diploma in Reproductive Medicine from Germany. She is a gynecologist, a laparoscopic surgeon, and infertility specialist. She is director of Sanidhya Multi-Speciality Hospital, Ahmedabad. She was a former secretary of BOGS. Over to you, Dr. Archana, for talking on dyspareunia.
Thank you, madam. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. You can share your screen now.
Yeah. I bring greetings from Ahmedabad to all of you. And the KFOG and the POGS has done an excellent work in organizing this CME. I also thank Dr. Neeraj for giving me this platform. My screen is seen, right?
Doctor? Not yet.
Is it seen now?
Back. You can double click.
It's seen?
No, not.
No. It is seen as black.
You have started screen sharing, but I think you have to click again on your presentation.
This is showing your screen sharing is paused. Now?
Yeah, now it's seen. It's seen now.
Slides are not moving. I'll just okay. So sorry for that. So thank you very much, Dr. Neeraj, for this platform. And I'll be speaking on dyspareunia. Dr. Savana has already mentioned why pain, and especially sexual pain, is important. The sexual pain, the chronic genital pain, has a negative impact on the psychological health, the relationship issues, and overall the quality of life. 3 out of 4 women would experience some sort of painful sex in their lifetime, and hence dyspareunia is so common. So we need to sort this out in our OPDs and help the women. Given the high prevalence of chronic genital pain and the relative lack of knowledge about this condition within the medical community, it is of utmost importance to gain a comprehensive understanding of this condition. We need to differentiate among different types of genital pain, understand the etiology, and so we can outline a treatment for these women. Various studies have reported a prevalence of 6 to 27% of the dyspareunia. And it can be still higher, as sex is still taboo in our OPDs and our patients. Disorders of sexual pain, vaginismus and dyspareunia, do not fit in any phase of the sexual cycle. In fact, the assumption that vaginismus and dyspareunia are distinct entities have been challenged. So vaginismus and dyspareunia would overlap, and genitopelvic pain disorder was previously referred to as sexual pain disorder consisting of dyspareunia or vaginismus, and usually these two conditions would overlap. Their etiology, the causes would be similar. So vaginismus and dyspareunia, they both seem to have the following 3 components: problems of muscle tension, voluntary or involuntary, limited to the vaginal muscle or extending to the pelvic floor at times, involving the adductor muscles, back, jaw, etc. Dr. Savana has mentioned about vaginismus in detail earlier. Fear of sexual pain associated with genital touching or coitus, or fear of intercourse for reasons other than pain, and tendency to avoid the intercourse altogether. If I come to dyspareunia, this is a recurrent or persistent genital pain associated with sexual intercourse. The This can also be subdivided into deep or superficial pain, and dyspareunia could also be with or without the vulvar vestibulitis syndrome. The VVS includes a painful penile vaginal intercourse or pain upon touching the vulvar vestibule, and signs are limited to the variable vestibular. Now, many of these conditions, they share a common etiology. The onus lies on us clinicians to identify the problem and give them adequate treatment. Now, what are the causes of sexual pain? First of all, if I see the superficial causes, it would be the VVS, the atrophy, vulvitis, or the vulvovaginitis. That is all infective etiologies like vulvitis, infections, interstitial cystitis, condylomata. Dermatological diseases could be there like lichen planus, non-infectious inflammations, epithelial defects, scarring, maybe because of previous episiotomy or previous normal delivery or any sexual abuse. Size of the penis, some women find the partner size big, urethritis, anatomical variations, hymenal remnants, episiotomy, neuroma, and radiation. Nowadays, a lot of women, as the cancer problems are increasing, the radiation, post-radiation also women would have dyspareunia. Here, the hymenal problems is, normally find that maybe the hymenal problems are very less, but just last week we had a case at our hospital where it was a subseptate hymen. So I have just shown you the pictures. The first picture is a pre-op picture. The couple presented for to us as a non-consummated marriage and dyspareunia. The husband was telling that the wife complained about dyspareunia. And they were married since last 3 years. And on examination, we found a septate hymen. And just a simple surgery helped this couple. So in the second picture, you can see once the hymen was excised, the introital opening was adequate for penetration. The deep causes for dyspareunia could be because of estrogen deficiency, especially seen in postmenopausal women, vaginitis, chronic PID, fibroid uterus, ovarian tumors, shortened vagina, maybe because of a hysterectomy. Endometriosis in an infertility clinic we do encounter. Vaginal septum, again urethritis, cystitis. Even piles, hemorrhoids can lead to dyspareunia. Fixed inverted uterus, ovarian remnant syndrome, chronic abdominal pain, irritable bowel syndrome. Ovarian remnant syndrome, again, is very common in our practice because when we do a total laparoscopic hysterectomy or a vaginal hysterectomy, especially after vaginal hysterectomy, the adnexa, the ovaries are brought at the apex, and that can lead to dyspareunia in these women. Coming to the diagnostic test, this is a complete slide of the test which can help these women. So one is a local examination, then the test for infection like cultures and wet mount examination. If needed, a biopsy, serum testing, ultrasound, laparoscopy, colposcopy in indicated patients, a bimanual examination, cystoscopy, electromyogram. In few cases, maybe a CT examination. Now, again, sexual dysfunction. When do you label the patient as having genitopelvic pain or penetration disorder? So the difficulties with vaginal penetration during intercourse, marked vulvovaginal or pelvic pain, fear or anxiety about pain, tensing or tightening of the pelvic floor muscles during attempted penetration, more than 6 months, it could be lifelong, acquired, mild, moderate, or severe. Now, types of genital pain. There are many established causes of genital pain that have defined etiologies and treatment. If I just define the vulvovaginal disease, it is defined as vulvar discomfort, most often described as burning pain, occurring in the absence of relevant visible findings or specific clinical or identifiable neurological disorder. Again, vulvodyna is an umbrella term. Thus, there are many different possible pain presentations. And the pain can be further specified according to when it occurs, whether provoked, unprovoked, or mixed. So vulvodyna is a very common term, and we encounter these kind of patients in our OPD, especially the elderly women. They complain about vague pain around the vulva, and these need to be attributed. On examination, you would find nothing positive in these cases, but a Q-tip test would help us to identify the points of the pain triggers in these cases. Now, how to approach a patient of pain, dyspareunia? Diagnostic approach in a patient of sexual pain. So medical history is very much important, whether the pain was there previously or not. Clinical investigations I have already listed. In a vulvodyna patient, a Q-tip test to map out the pain trigger points. Relational and sexual history, whether the pain is with the partner or past negative sexual experiences, what are the sexual expectations, psychological history, any history of depression, mental problems, or any other medical disorders. This is a slide showing how we can differentiate the causes. If you go into detail of the sexual history, we can identify the cause. For example, in process, there would be symptoms of vulvodyna too. Malformations, normally it would be an introital pain. Malformations, again, hymenal malformations or vaginal septums. Then genital mutation, again, pain can be introital, superficial, or deep pains. Post-radiation chemotherapy, again, both pains are there. Dryness and reduced lubrication is the main issue. Vulvodyna, the pain is normally introital, that is a superficial pain. So this slide can help us. We need to ask the patient whether the pain is on superficial, that is an introital pain, or it is a deep-seated pain. Hypoestrogenism, we all clinicians know, can lead to dyspareunia. This is just a flow diagram showing how the less estrogen leads to dyspareunia. It leads to decreased vaginal folding. The elasticity of the vaginal tissues are lost, and that can lead to increased infection, or if there is any trauma, can lead to dyspareunia. So thinning of the vaginal epithelium, the exfoliation, decreased glycogen production, decreased number of lactobacilli, decreased production of lactic acid, increased vaginal pH can lead to overgrowth of the other bacteria, leading to urine infections, and that can lead to dyspareunia. Coming to the treatment of these patients, after a thorough case history and assessment, we need to see what is the pain type and intensity. The pelvic floor problem is there. Interpersonal relationship is there. Psychological condition. Of course, the treatment is multidisciplinary, and we can individualize the treatment depending on the cause. Pain management, systemic desensitization, cognitive restructuring, pelvic floor exercises, sensate focus exercises, and mindfulness. All this has been addressed in the previous lectures. Now, main roadblock when you are treating these patients, why? What happens? Sexual dysfunctions are not being recognized as recognized disorders, and it's still a taboo subject in the health workers. Amongst the patients, there is self-stigmatization, including feelings of shame and guilt. So they are not coming out with their problems. In the OPD, a health worker needs to ask leading questions. Then only patients open up. The healthcare professionals, then they are not standardly inquiring about the sexual difficulties. We have seen a lot of doctors who are not comfortable addressing the sexual problems of the patients. So these are all the roadblocks which can lead to not proper treatment in these patients. When before coming to the treatment, let me address, although some causes of dyspareunia, such as history of sexual abuse or trauma, can be avoided, we can decrease the risk of yeast infection in these patients. They can be counseled to avoid tight clothing, wear cotton underpants, practice good hygiene, change underclothes frequently, bath and shower daily. To avoid bladder infections, wipe from the front to the back after using the toilet and urinate after sexual intercourse. These are some of the tips which you can counsel the patient and tell them. Avoid sexually transmitted disease, avoid sex or practice safe sex. Only one partner, use condoms to protect against STDs. To prevent vaginal dryness, may use lubricants. I will come into detail of the lubricants later on. If you have endometriosis, avoid very deep penetrative sex or have sex during week or two after menstruation, that is before ovulation, when the condition tends to be less painful. These are some of the tips we can give our patients. Psychosocial interventions includes basic counseling, physiotherapy, psychosexual interventions. These have been addressed in the previous lectures already. Approaches to improve physical intimacy, educate patients about the sexual behaviors and responses, allay their fears and anxiety, enhance stimulation through changes in sexual techniques and routine. This is very much important. We need to counsel the patients to have a good foreplay during their sexual act. Remember, the males are like a matchstick and the women are like an iron rod. They would take time to get properly stimulated. So foreplay is very much important so that the woman is lubricated and she would have less pain during penetrative sex. Use distraction techniques to increase relaxation and eliminate anxiety. Psychosexual interventions, just I would list them: body awareness education, cognitive therapies, behavioral therapy, psychodynamic therapy. All these again have been addressed by Dr. Queen in detail. I would come to the vaginal moisturizers and lubricants. They are recommended as a first-line treatment in mild to moderate vaginal dryness and where local estrogen treatment is contraindicated. Moisturizers, they have the ability to retain and accumulate water and thus mimicking physiological vaginal secretions. It provides quick relief of local symptoms, especially dryness. And clinical benefits would be moisturizers are water-based. It's a main ingredient, great for sensitive skin, easy to clean off, and not great for the shower bath because they would wash up. Since they are water-based, after a shower, they would go away. So they are not very long-lasting. There are many water-based lubricants which can be used. They also come with added fragrances. The other lubricants are silicone-based. They have a unique silky feel, usually hypoallergenic, super slippery, and they would last much longer than the water-based. And they can work for water play, can be used with condoms. The other lubricants we commonly use are KY jelly, glycerin containing, and only thing in this, the patient has more incidence of yeast infection. So we need to take care of that. And the other thing is in the patients who want to conceive, the infertility patients, we cannot advise them to use lubricants. This is a list of the medication options. Moisturizers and lubricants I have discussed. Estrogens, androgens, DHEA, SERMs, and sub-agent techniques. Local estrogen therapy, all of gynecologists are using Evelon and Premarin cream in postmenopausal women. There are also vaginal tablets, vaginal creams, and also rings. Typical administration schedule consists of an initiation dose to be taken daily for approximately 2 weeks, and then the patient is put on maintenance therapy. There is L-arginine gels also, which are available in the market. They also helps in sexual stimulation. The gel is applied topically once or twice a day. Some selective estrogen receptor modulators are used in some cases. They are synthetic non-steroidal agents that exert a variable agonistic, antagonistic, or neutral effect on the estrogenic receptors of the target tissue. Androgens, testosterone therapy has already been discussed in the lectures which address the hyposexual disorders. The options available are patches and also creams and gel forms. DHEA also has been addressed. Just to summarize, it can be converted into a variety of biological active steroids, and it has been recently approved for management of moderate or severe dyspareunia in menopausal women. In the placebo controlled trials, DHEA vaginal ovules inserted daily decreased the vaginal pH and improved the vaginal epithelial maturation index and epithelial thickness with an improvement in dyspareunia and sexual function. Coming to other therapies, nowadays we are seeing a lot of vaginal rejuvenation therapies. I think so. We have a session on cosmetic gynec later on. Laser therapy is used. The recent approach is based on local stimulation aimed at increasing the production of collagen in order to improve the elasticity and functionality of the vaginal wall. It also works in the cancer survivors where we cannot use the estrogen. The PRP is also used in a lot of patients. It can be combined with stem cells, hyaluronic acid. PRP also has been tried by a lot of doctors in cases of dyspareunia. So to summarize the approach to a patient of dyspareunia, the first line is addressing the modifiable factors, non-pharmacological interventions like sexual education. If the mild symptoms are there, we can go to non-hormonal local therapies. If the symptoms are moderate to severe, then the other therapies can be tried. So this is a flowchart of the treatment in cases of dyspareunia. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Archana Shah, for that wonderful presentation, management of dyspareunia. And the session is now open for discussion. Do we have time for question answers, Dr. Kunjumaydeen? I don't find any questions in the chat box.
Maybe one or two questions, madam. Chairpersons can ask a few questions.
Ananda Mohan, sir, you want to add something because you're practicing sexual medicine?
Yeah, one, I would like to comment to that in the first session on sexuality and sex education. It was shown how common sexual abuses, especially in childhood and adolescence. In our practice, many of these FSDs, we find it's very difficult to elicit that history. When we go deeper, we find that a lot of them have had sexual abuse in childhood and early adolescence. It need not be a penetrative sex. Even an attempt, and we had a session with about 2,000 adolescent girls over a period of 1 year. And we found that most of these abuses come from very elderly people, very young girls being sexually abused by very elderly people. And even if a non-penetrative sexual abuse causes a lot of problems and a lot of this sort of female sexual dysfunction. That history is very important, I think, when we deal with this sort of a problem. Thank you.
I would like to know whether these drugs you told about, that is buspirone and bupropion, are all available here? Are they available?
I don't know. I have not come across in Kerala anyway. Anyone else?
Yes, ma'am. Availability is very meager. But online, a lot of things are actually available nowadays. Even fibenserin, which we were, even a few months back, we were wondering whether it's available. It is. Buspirone and those things are really not freely available, but really if available. Required, can be arranged online. Nowadays, almost anything can be arranged, but it is not freely available, and we don't have any experience as such. Whatever we can speak about is from the Western world, whatever information we gather from there.
Prion and bupropion, both are available in the market. They are psychiatric drugs, usually used as antidepressants. They are easily available for psychiatric treatment. Of course, they can be used by the gynecologist.
Yes, sir. But in case of HSDD, we don't have too much of experience as far as they are concerned. Thereby,
they are used only to change the type of medications. If they are on antidepressants of some other type, they can be changed to bupropion, because they have got lesser side effect of sexual dysfunction.
Ribanserin nowadays is available, but very few of us are using it.
Yeah.
Niraj sir,
thank you so much.
Any comments, Niraj sir?
No, yesterday only we were talking about this sexual abuse, because nowadays what problem is that if you see nuclear family, there are no one to look after the children, and they are more prone to the sexual abuse. So yesterday only we were talking about this issue here.
Sir, can you kindly increase your volume, sir?
Hello. Now I am audible?
Yeah, audible.
Yes.
Not only we were talking about the sexual abuse issue in the children, because nowadays what happens, due to nuclear family, there are no one to look after the children, and sometimes we have to depend upon our the servants and helper to look after our servant, and there are more chances of sexual abuse by them. So we have to be very cautious about that.
Thank you. We'll wind up the session. Thank you, the speakers, Dr. Dilpreet, Dr. Kyun Aditya, Dr. Pani, Dr. Sharad sir, Dr. Savana, Dr. Archana, and the wonderful chairpersons, Dr. Ambuja ma'am, Dr. Gracie, and Dr. Andaman sir. So thank you.
Congratulations for the nice.
Thank you, sir. It was really wonderful to hear the interactions. Thank you, the speakers and chairpersons. We'll move on to the next session.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
For the next session, I would like to invite the chairpersons. We have Dr. Krishnendu Gupta from Kolkata. Sorry, sir, there was some miscommunication in the communications. Sorry for the trouble. And sir is a senior consultant, gynecology and infertility from Kolkata, and the sexual medicine consultant, and the member of Sexual Medicine Committee of SAFO.